George Martin is arguably the most highly decorated and influential music producer in the Western world since the invention of rock and roll in the 1950s. He is best known as being the main producer for the Beatles. He has been the driving force behind a massive 31 number one hit singles in the UK and 23 hits in America. His career title is a long one, and this can be attributed to his immense talent and vision in all elements of music. Officially, George Martin is a producer, arranger, composer, conductor, audio engineer, and musician. Sir George Henry Martin was born on the 3rd of January 1926 in England. At the tender age of 6, Martin laid eyes on his first instrument, a piano, which Martin's parents had acquired. 2 years later, Martin convinced his parents that he should get piano lessons, and they wholeheartedly agreed, as he had shown a keen ability and aptitude for music as soon as the piano had come in the front door.
There's the original number one.
Due to World War II, Martin moved around through various schools in England, including St. Joseph's Elementary, St. Ignatius College, and then the Bromley Grammar School. From 1943 until 1947, he worked for the English War Office and also the Fleet Air Arm of the English Royal Navy. He became a commissioned officer and a pilot, but was fortunate enough not to see combat. This proved to be an important stepping stone for Martin, as he received a war grant, which he used to enrol in the Guildhall School of Music and Drama between 1947 and 1950. There he studied oboe and piano. Also during these years, at the age of 22, he married Sheena Chisholm. They would later divorce and Martin would remarry in 1966 to Judy Lockhart Smith.
And that leads into...
After a short stint working for the BBC Classical Music Department, he joined the label Parlophone as an assistant engineer, which was a small subsidiary label of EMI, which by many in the industry was considered a novelty. When Oscar Proust, the former head of Parlophone, retired in 1955, Martin stepped up to run the label.
Tick, 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 tick.
It would be 7 years before Martin would meet John Lennon and Paul McCartney. In this time between 1955 and 1962, he worked with several comedy and novelty acts, including Peter Sellers, Spike Milligan, and Harry Secombe, who together made up the radio comedy act The Goons. The Goons are famous in British comedy history for their radio program, which ran for the majority of the 50s.
You got to rock and roll with your old kickbag, but you mustn't ever mention her name in the mess. And if you want to know the title of this number, it's a Major Dennis Brudnut rock and roll called Rumba. Left.
Some other comedy acts Martin worked with include Beyond the Fringe Show and also Rolf Harris.
Shove a bullet up the spout. That's a dance they do from a dress to Pango Pango. It's a Major Dennis Brudnut rock and roll called Tango.
Martin's effect on the music and entertainment industry is often just quantified as his visionary and culture-changing achievements with the Beatles. But his work during the first 7 years running Parlophone also had a profound effect on the genesis of popular Western culture. Most notably, Martin's work with the Goons was key in destabilizing what can be described as a strict and overly professional socio-cultural norm, which was especially present in England and America after the Second World War.
It's me old childhood sweetheart, Spotty Minnie Bannister, the darling of Roper's Lighthouse. Bless my soul, madam.
His work as a producer for many novelty acts at the time was key in breaking the regimented culture, and this helped make way for the flower power and hippie culture of the 60s and 70s. The following is George Martin's good friend Spike Milligan breaking that regimented culture by interrupting in the middle of the ABC News.
Asked about criticism of him by two former ministers, Mr. Gorton and Mr. Killen.
And Spike Milligan.
The Prime Minister was met at the airport by his two children and members of the Cabinet, including the Treasurer, Mr. Snedden, and Spike Milligan.
In 1962, rock and roll had established itself as a genre, thanks to the breakthrough work of Elvis Presley and many other rock pioneers. Now came the second dawn of rock and roll. That same year, George released Time Beat under the pseudonym Ray Cathode. Martin wanted to capitalise on the UK's budding rock scene as to enable the label Parlophone to stay afloat, so he started looking for a suitable group to work with. Martin's first contact with the Beatles was through Brian Epstein, the then manager of the group. On the 13th of February 1962, he first heard the sound of the Beatles. He described the sound as unpromising, but did like McCartney's and Lennon's vocals. In June of the same year, the Beatles auditioned by recording at Abbey Road. Martin heard the tracks and finally met the group and described the songwriting as below par, but the wit and humour that the group carried with them made Martin warm to them and sign off on a recording contract. Unbeknownst to Martin, this decision would unwittingly propel the Beatles to be one of the biggest bands of all time. It's all right. Martin acted as the arranger for the first album, Please Please Me, which was recorded in November 1962, in which he played piano on a number of songs. During these first sessions, Martin was unhappy with Ringo Starr's drumming, a recent addition to the band, so he used a session drummer, Andy White. Tangible evidence of how Martin steered the SS Beatles into stardom includes the string quartet heard on Yesterday, a track that has gone down in history as one of the most well-known songs. He also arranged, conducted, and recorded the scores to Penny Lane and Eleanor Rigby. This is the start of the track, Please Please Me, by the Beatles. Dichotomy between the musically trained Martin and the mainly musically untrained Beatles often augmented itself into strange and groundbreaking new techniques. These include the splicing together of two takes recorded in different tempo for the track Strawberry Fields Forever. This track has become timeless thanks to Martin's splicing, as it results in the very unique and characterized sounds and tone color that helps make the song so successful. Let me take you down, 'cause I'm going to Strawberry Fields. Another notable example of Martin's brilliance can be heard at the end of Day in the Life and the chaotic orchestral wall of sound. In 1965, Martin left EMI but continued to work in a freelance capacity where he was in great demand. As a result of this, he was unavailable for a number of Beatles sessions during the latter half of the 60s. He did, however, score Yellow Submarine as well as produce the band's final album, Abbey Road. As the relationship between Martin and the Beatles grew, so did the band's interest in the studio environment. He encouraged this, and over the course of the 60s, they together pushed the boundaries and broke the status quo of how the studio was used to track down sound. Martin saw the studio as another instrument and another way to extend the boundaries of music. This is one of the reasons why the Beatles were such a roaring success, because their sound set them apart from the norm at the time. Martin's work with the Beatles influenced and inspired millions of musicians around the world. Without this collaboration, the genesis of the Western music industry would have been profoundly different. It is often forgotten that Martin is famous for being the driving force behind many other sounds in the music and entertainment industry, not just the Beatles. These include the seven albums with America, the album Blow by Blow and Wired by Jeff Beck, various albums by Ultravox, Cheap Trick, UFO, Jimmy Webb, Neil Sedaka, Gary Brooker, Kenny Rogers, and countless others. He also recorded two of Paul McCartney's solo albums, including Tug of War and Pipes of Peace. In addition to all this, Martin also worked hard in the film industry to create some of the most striking sounds ever to be put to film. Some of these films include Honky Tonk Freeway, Pulp, Optimus at Nine Elms, The Family Way, A Hard Day's Night, for which he was nominated for an Academy Award. Martin also produced two James Bond themes, the first of which was Goldfinger, sung by Shirley Bassey.
It's the kiss of death from Mr. Goldfinger.
And the second was Live and Let Die by Paul McCartney and Wings, for which he won a Grammy.
Well, for more than 30 years, George, as an international record producer, you've been the talented and patient guiding hand to set so many stars on the road to success.
Martin had a profound effect on the entire Western music industry. Whether it was breaking the stiff cultural norms with the likes of the Goons, or collaborating with the Beatles to make the number one, most successful, popular, and loved band of all time, the brilliance and importance of Sir George Martin's work is undisputed, and he will go down in history as one of the world's greatest music producers. In 1998, Martin commenced work on his second last ever studio recording. He commissioned the help of many of his friends and heroes to create In My Life. The likes of Robin Williams, Jeff Beck, Goldie Hawn, Phil Collins, Celine Dion, Jim Carrey, Billy Connolly, Sean Connery, and many more can be heard on this 14-track album. This is track 11 from that album. It is an original orchestral score by Martin and is thought to be a lament and homage to the death of John Lennon. The track is called Friends and Lovers.
Honor today, you know. I think we honor great artists, and certainly George is the definitive artist.
I've been in a record studio producing records now for 47 years, which is quite a long time. And I've recorded everybody from classical symphony orchestra choirs, Adrian Bolton, people like that, string quartets, piano pieces, Scottish country dance music, Jimmy Shand, children's records, Enid Blyton, comedy records, pop records, rock and roll, jazz, Stan Getz, and I covered the field, I think. And if you turn me upside down, you will see notes falling out of my ears. So I thought, this is the summation of it all, and it's in my life. That's what it is. Simple.
The sheer number of accolades and awards Martin has received. It's astonishing. An Academy Award nomination, 6 Grammys, 2 Brit Awards, British Phonographic Industries Man of the Year 1998, an honorary doctorate in music, induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, Lifetime Achievement Award from the World Soundtrack Academy, and also a knighthood. These are just a few on a very, very long list. Sir George Martin is the humble visionary who has influenced the music of 3 generations. And counting.